as with anything in pop culture, everything is full circle. So with a Stevie Ray Vaughan or someone like that coming along and reviving it, suddenly it's what's old is new again. That's what happened with the pedal. It goes down and comes back up.
Certainly on his remake of Voodoo Child, but also on Soul to Soul. In fact, I've heard that Stevie put two wah pedals together and worked them both simultaneously. And I don't know if that's absolutely true, but that it makes a good story.
Kind of the 80s were kind of wah-wah free, maybe, or not used very often, I should say. And then when the Seattle scene hit and all, you know, Alice in Chains, and then the heavier guys like Metallica and all this, they started using it in solos, and it came back into vogue again. Those guys were using it in a new and tasteful way. It became fresh again.
And it was just like a natural thing for me to do, like, you know, using a guitar pick or you know, using a guitar strap. You know, for as far as I'm concerned, that, you know, the ship probably sailed out and came back and I didn't even notice, you know. I was still sitting there on the docks going whacka 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 whacka.
I think I may have had one before I met the guys in Alice, but in like the end of 87. But that's when I completely fell in love with it. There's quite a few of our songs which are totally based off of Crybaby riff, you know, Man in the Box being the first and most obvious one. You know, I think I like laid that down on a four track or whatever, and then I started messing around with it, and I think I came up with that line like almost immediately, you know, and it's just a simple little note run. There's nothing really special about it, but what makes it come alive is the Crybaby. And then also layering a little bit of a talk box behind it, it really makes it speak. So many guys use it, and use it well, you know. I mean, I really dig how Slash plays, and his solo work with a Crybaby is pretty amazing.
It's, you know, sometimes it goes, it's in vogue, and then it'll be out of vogue for a minute and whatnot. I've just been using it because I'm able to express myself in a certain way with the wah-wah pedal that is very important to me. So I just stick with it regardless. I don't care whether it's in vogue or not.
I think why it's still around and why it still works, and, you know, just like beer and pretzels and peanut butter and jelly, you know, certain things just are not going to go out of style. You know, like a Marshall, a Les Paul, you know, Strat, and, you know, wah-wah pedal. Can't beat it, man. And it's really good for, you know, the weight distribution. Like if you want to, you know, if you're locked out of your car, you know, tossing it out the window and stuff like that, getting into the car, it's very effective.
So many different artists from so many different schools of music can come along with engineers and producers and arrangers, and find a use for it that is, in their hands, maybe brand new.
For me, the signature thing I've done, I think that the wah pedal is this intro to the song, Damn, We Call It Tweakers, where it just sounds like a loop of some kind of like siren or something. It just goes. I was just sitting around with playing a chord that I stole from Robert Fripp. It's ugly, and taking the wah pedal and going. And it's, you know, as soon as we did that in rehearsal, I was like, oh man, this is the whole new thing here with this pedal. I can do this all day. I got a whole new vocabulary now.
There's lots of people that had a different take on it. A 12-year-old kid could go into a guitar store because he heard Nirvana, or he heard grunge music where people were making these sounds that just sounded really distorted. And then there was some, you know, wah filtering, but it wasn't the kind that you would hear on a porn tape or some other thing. It was the kind of thing that just jumped out of the speakers in an aggressive way. And that's what appealed to a lot of kids. And they said, now I want to use it for sound effects, but not the typical thing.
You know, a lot of guys, even if they don't move the wah-wah pedal a lot, they'll find this, you know, like a sweet spot.
Like a sweet spot.
The sweet spot.
The sweet spot.
Michael Schenker does this all the time. He finds that sweet spot, and he plays the most blistering stuff.
I think Michael Schenker used one that was kind of clicked on all the time.
And fixed in a position.
To give him a certain tone.
Just sort of, it's more like an EQ, but it has a special character that no EQ has other than a wah-wah.
I saw him when I was a kid, and I remember he had a wah, and it didn't look like the wah went the whole way. I remember being watching like close at San Diego Sports Arena, and Michael Schenker's wah looked like it only went from here to here, but he was on it all the time.
And it was a really unique sound that he had, and a lot of people used to try and get it, but they didn't know that that's how he was doing it.
I don't start with the wah at the beginning of the chain. The wah comes a little further down the chain.
I plug my guitar into it and everything else after. So it's the first thing.
Yeah, I always liked it first. I don't know. I mean, it worked, so I didn't mess with it.
And I like to put some distortion boxes and such that happen before the wah pedal, okay, not after. Because I want to filter the distorted sound.
But you always have the wah right at the end of the, you know, the chain there. It's just for harmonics a lot of times. And then, you know, for, like you said, solo boosts and stuff like that for the treble boosts and everything like that.
It always goes at the very end of everything. Because I like the, any effects, I want them to go through that at the end. I don't want like a wah sound then going through a phaser. Just to me, it just starts to lose everything. And
I like to use the wah-wah as an effect. While I'm mixing, if, for instance, I find that there's a really cool part that the wah has not been used, I'll incorporate the wah. I'll bring it into a patch bay here, bring it through the console, and I'll actually set it up in such a way that I'll find my high point and low point, and I'll just go wah, 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 wah. After I've done the effect of the wah, then I'll put a pan on it, and then I'll hand pan it from side to side so it goes in time with the how much I've gone up and down, the pan will go left to right, which is kind of what I did with Jimmy. Because if you listen to some of the wah-wah things that I did with Hendrix, I used the pan to project the wah all the way across, and then if he's doing wap-wap-wap, I'll do wap-wap-wap-wap like that, whip it back and forth.
I like to do things like on some songs on records, I plug the guitar into it, and then into the pedals, and then into the amp. But a lot of times I'll take and I'll plug them in after. I'll go into the distortions and I'll overdrive the heck out of the input of the wah. And I describe it as a sound of like, if you have a giant pipe full of water and it's full of pressure, and then you're trying to squeeze that into a teeny tiny pipe, which is the wah, and then as you move it, it's like opening of water valves. And that's when the wah starts to really sound like a massive amount of frequency. I use it then almost as a tone generator, like as opposed to wow, wow, wow.
And then, of course, last but not least, classic wah wah. Gotta do it. Sometimes you might want to make the guitar sing and scream. Sometimes you might just want to make a racket with it. And what it's basically is octave fuzz with the wah kicked in. So you get some serious noise going. Check it out. Right now, I think I just want to go drink a double off of it. So I'm about out of here. Y'all need something else?
I think anybody who wants to learn how to incorporate the Crybaby into their setup basically has to get a pretty good understanding of what it is that they're going for. And then just sort of toy around with it till it sounds right to you. Crybaby is a very personal effect. The way that it sounds is totally at the mercy of the user. So you have to figure out what it is that you want to get out of it and then try and pull that off.
The degree that you take it to depends on your rhythms within yourself. Like I say, you can say, one, two, three, four, and that's wah-wah playing, but it's not creating in the wah-wah that you can do. You can do creations, but you have to have it in your feet.
But probably the main advice, you know, I'm sure anybody who stands next to somebody who's never used a wah pedal before is don't overuse it.
You can't overuse it. It has been overused. And in all fairness, I got to be the guy that says this. I have heard it overused where, like, there are guys that can't play a solo without it. But, you know, used tastefully, it's one of the sweetest things you can have in your rig.
And again, it's part of your musical voice. You got to make it part of just like coming up with a new riff. Now suddenly it's a new riff, maybe with the wah-wah pedal. And each individual has to come to, what are they trying to communicate?
I look at all of the pedals that I use, it's like different languages. And the wah-wah pedal express one language, the fuzz express another one. The phase shifter just kind of mellows everything out.
I think a lot of people get hung up on gear, like the guitar you play, the crybaby you play, the amps you play through. And that's a part of it, but it's the individual uniqueness really comes from your hands, you know, and it really does, the voice of the guitar. So I don't think a crybaby is really going to change your style, but it's maybe going to amplify what you already are and give you more options.
And please believe me, it's a learning thing. It's like when you learn how to play the guitar, piano, whatever it is, each and every day you learn something about the special effects that you did not know about, and I'm still learning at it.
It's just an extension, you know, any effect, flanger, phaser, wah-wah, they're just to help you express whatever you're trying to speak, you know, whatever you're trying to say, whatever message you're trying to deliver through your playing or emotion or, you know.
And I think people that even don't play guitar can watch somebody on stage and they can see their foot moving and they can hear the effect being generated as they're moving their foot. And seeing their fingers work the fretboard while this effect is changing the frequencies that they're hearing. And I think that's just very unendingly captivating for people.
It's a dynamic thing, so every moment is new. You can never replicate perfectly a wah-wah passage. That's what makes it organic, and that's what makes it timeless.
I can't see it going away. It's just too easy to use, too fun to hear. It's so flexible for the artist to make use of and to add to their creative palette.
This pedal is a pretty simple concept, but it sounds so different the way different people play it. That just speaks to the creativity of musicians in general, but how this one pedal can work in so many different ways for so many people and for so many different instruments and make so many people say, man, that sounds cool.
It's great at making faces, too, and that's one of my favorite things about playing rock music. I always recommend, if you're a guitar player, make as many faces as you can and link them up to the sounds. And the wah-wah is just going to take that and multiply it by 10.
When and where did I get my first crybaby? Not sure. I probably got it used off one of my buddies that was another guitar player in the neighborhood or something like that, you know, back in New Jersey somewhere. But, well, you know how it is when you're a kid, just saving up all your dough, mowing lawns, and, you know, whatever else you got to do, pumping gas.
I worked in high school selling Christmas trees one Christmas at a grocery store.
I borrowed some money from my aunt, and I bought my first crybaby. I think it was like $30 or something. I remember I had to work the money off mowing the lawn and doing various around the house chores.
You know, I used to have a wah-wah and I had a switch on it and it went oi oi too. It was really bizarre. Never seen one again. I guess wah. People preferred wah instead of oi oi. So
I don't leave. It's like the American Express card, man. I don't leave home without it.
Have you ever used the crybaby to get out of a jam, like break a window in your car to get the keys out or something like that?
No, I've bartered for wine with them before.
Oh, that's awesome.
I just know that if a guitar player walks in the studio with a great sounding wah-wah and knows how to use it, he's my man.
If I had to do a show, that's the one thing I would have to have. Not even a guitar. A microwave, you know, I don't know, flashlight.
I know. I didn't start this whole thing thinking I was going to dedicate my life to a wah-wah pedal, but so far it's kind of turned out to be that way.
Every time I hear some songs, I listen to hear if somebody's going to pop up with a wah-wah.
I'm addicted, I think.